Lampo Press presents Punch Fear in the Face, Escape Average, Do Work That Matters, Start by Jon Acuff, read by the author.
Dad, why is Ellie's name mentioned 3 times in the dedication to Quitter and my name is mentioned only once? Said McCray, my then 5-year-old daughter. Great question. You can write the dedication to the next book, I replied. Good. I'll say to Jenny, McCray, and Ellie. By McCray. Chapter 1. You Are Here. If you ever fly Korean Air, keep your eyes closed as you make your way to coach. You may have to feel your way there, but trust me, that momentary inconvenience is worth it. You do not want to see the first class seats. The challenge is that you enter from the front of the plane. If your eyes are open, you're immediately thrust into an aeronautical wonderland. First class isn't full of seats. It's full of tiny pods of luxury. They have their own little sleeping cocoons in which to lounge away the 16-hour flight. And if you see these pleasure domes as you walk to your seat, you're going to get sad. So that you fully comprehend what's happening as you pass through the seating classes, Korean Air color codes the seats. The pleasure domes in first class are woven in a periwinkle blue fabric that seems to tickle you lightly and whisper, "Don't you wish this flight were longer?" The next class of seats is light blue, like the color of an apron you'd buy at Williams-Sonoma after being wooed into the store by the smell of boysenberry muffins. The business class is dark blue, serious but still seriously comfortable. Finally, at the end of the color wheel, and back of the plane, you get to coach class, your seat, which is brown, the color of disappointment. The other thing it'd be good for you to know, should you ever find yourself flying to Asia, is that Vietnam is not close to South Korea. I thought they were like Connecticut and Rhode Island, that maybe I could look out the window from the airport in Seoul and see Vietnam across the water. I was wrong. After flying 16 hours from Atlanta to South Korea, we had to fly another 6 hours from Seoul to Hanoi. We then boarded an overnight train to travel deeper into the country. I don't know if there were periwinkle first-class seats available on that train, but I do know we didn't get them. The shared bathroom was just a metal hole in the floor that dropped straight onto the tracks. I thought it was kind of fun. My wife felt differently. After a solid night of rumbling through moonlit mountains, we arrived in Sapa. From there, we drove another 7 hours on dirt roads overlooking cliffs. Imagine the most dangerous road you've ever been on. Remove all the guardrails and then add water buffalo. Finally, after hours of breathtaking scenery punctuated by moments of sheer panic, we came upon something I never expected to see. French motorcyclists. My initial confusion was that they weren't on skinny 10-speed bikes from the 1960s with long sticks of crusty French bread sticking out of wicker baskets, and none of them were wearing jaunty berets. Everything I know about France I learned from puzzles, and it's completely okay for me to poke fun at France. The only language my books have ever been translated into is German. I'm like Hasselhoff over there. Decked out in apocalyptic-looking safety gear and a week's worth of dirt, they were obviously a long way from home. Lost in the deepest middle of nowhere I'd ever experienced, the bikers were gesturing to some Vietnamese villagers huddled around a map that was unfolded on the handlebars of one of the bikes. We pulled over to the side of the road to help them find their next destination. Steve, an American who had lived in Asia for 18 years, looked out the bus window at the biker's map. "Wow," he said to Hoa, our Vietnamese driver, "that is an amazing map. Look how detailed it is. We should get one of those." Then he paused just before lowering his window and said, "Then again, the best map in the world doesn't matter if you don't know where you are." Steve was right. Without a point of origin, even the best map is rendered useless. If you opened up the GPS on your phone right now and tried to get directions, the very first thing the phone would need to know is, where are you? Google Earth can't give you directions across the state or even across the street without a point of origin. Yet most of us, when it comes to figuring out where we're headed in life, never stop to ask the simple question, where am I? We just keep marching forward, day after day, cubicle after cubicle, moving faster and faster, but not really going anywhere. Eventually, at the end of our lives, we start to do some questioning. We finally pause long enough to re-examine our decisions and maybe even ask hard questions of young, single-browed authors on airplanes. That's what a grandmother in her early 70s did to me on a flight from Dallas to Baltimore. She was flying back from a gambling trip in Reno with her sister. They were two grandmothers on the run, laughing and joking with each other in the back of a Southwest plane. During the flight, I gave her a copy of my last book, Quitter. I promise I don't do that every time I fly. I don't wear cargo pants full of my books and then say, oh, what's this? How did this get in my pocket? That's crazy. It's my Wall Street Journal best-selling book. I'll sign it for you, but please, no flash photography. It dries out my pores. But we had been talking about life and dreams, and giving her a copy of Quitter, which addresses both, seemed like an okay thing to do. Now, a side note is, it's always awkward as an author when you give somebody a book and they start to read it beside you, because you kind of look out of the corner of your eye and think to yourself, is it changing their life right now? Are their teeth already brighter due to my wisdom? She got out highlighters and post-it notes. But after she had been reading it for an hour, she leaned in to speak over the engine noise and asked me a question I wasn't ready for. What do you do when all the excuses you use to not chase your dream are gone? What do you do then? There was sadness in her words, a sense of fear and resignation that seemed to suck all the joy out of a boisterous weekend trip with her sister. Sadder still, I didn't have an answer for her. I didn't know the answer, but I knew there was one. There had to be, because I didn't want you or me to get to 80 or 90 years old and realize we mortgaged the best years of our lives doing something we weren't called to do. I didn't want to look back on life and wonder where it all went. That happened to me once when I was 30. Through a series of bad decisions, I finally woke up one day in a cubicle and realized I'd coasted through the last 10 years of my life. And I knew that the same thing would happen again if I wasn't careful. Realizing where I was headed, I started to write about that woman's question. I wrote 50,000 words trying to find the answer, but like most things in life, it snuck up on me when I was looking the other way. One afternoon, while meeting with a friend, I started to dissect Dave Ramsey's life on a whiteboard. He's been an incredibly successful author and businessman, something I aspire to be too. I was curious how he accomplished so much. As I started to map out the trajectory of his life, I made a simple discovery about what it takes to be awesome. It's not that complicated or unique. In fact, since the dawn of time, every awesome life has gone through the same 5 stages. Number 1, learning. Number 2, editing. Number 3, mastering. Number 4, harvesting. Number 5, guiding. Like a simple map through life, those are the 5 stages on the road to awesome. And until recently, they have matched up pretty closely with your age. In your 20s, you resided in learning. You went to college, got a job, or joined the military. You didn't yet know what you were made of, so you sampled many endeavors and did as much as you could to learn about yourself, the world around you, and where you best fit in. In your 30s, you moved on up to editing. You started to focus on the handful of things that worked really well in your 20s. You were not done learning, but you started editing down the list of things you thought were really important. You prioritized your passions. You eliminated old habits that wrecked you in your 20s and concentrated on doing more of the things you love and less of the things you hate. It was a winnowing period. You focused your career, your relationships, and every part of your life. In your 40s, you ascended to mastering. You edited your life to the most important things in your 30s, and then it came time to master them. You were going to be an awesome parent, awesome friend, awesome employee, etc. You didn't narrow your life further. You just had greater certainty about what you were good at and how to do it regularly. You were no longer the young upstart at work. You were the one with 15 to 20 years of experience. Tried and true. You started leading bigger projects and initiatives. You were not an expert yet, but you were next in line. In your 50s, you basked in harvesting. The seeds you planted in your 20s, 30s, and 40s finally began blooming. You made the most money in your career during this decade and reaped what you sowed. This wasn't rocket science. If you spent your 30s and 40s working hard to be considered an expert in your field, you would obviously have more job opportunities than if you jumped around 47 times and blamed your bosses for not recognizing your talent. If you are deliberate about pouring into relationships in your 20s, 30s, and 40s, Guess what? You harvested abundant relationships in your 50s. When your collegiate son crashed his car, you harvested an outpouring of support and love. Lots of people came to the hospital, and someone probably even brought a casserole. In your 60s, you entered a place of guiding. You retired with a gold watch and a ranch-style home in Florida. You were a grandfather or a grandmother. You were the elder statesman, the one with the wisdom. You got to give back generously to people who were traveling the path on which you spent 40-plus years. Corncob pipe whittling was not mandatory, but highly likely. If you wanted to achieve awesomeness...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.